May I come in, sir?
Please come.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. Thank you, sir.
Well, can you just tell about yourself, your background, academic background, and what you are doing at present?
Yes, sir. So, my name is Pratibha Verma. I am from Sultanpur, Uttar Pradesh. I was born and brought up there. I completed my schooling there only. After that, I completed my graduation from IIT Delhi in Engineering Physics branch. Post that, I joined Vodafone as deputy manager and I worked there for 2 years. After that, in 2016, I came for civil services preparation. Last year, I cleared civil services and Indian Forest Services examination both. So right now I have joined Income Tax Department and I have taken UL for giving one more attempt in order to pursue my dream of becoming an IAS.
All right. Tell me, this telecom company, what future do you see of so many players, you know, all making losses, and especially the disruptive, to disrupt the economy, some of the players are have played a very proactive role.
Yes, sir.
In this telecom
yes.
sector, with the result that most of them are into losses.
Yes, sir.
So, what do you think will happen in the next 5 years? Will you think that they will all merge with each other, somebody will vanish, and the subscribers will suffer, and maybe the monopolistic tendencies will come in the sector? You have worked in Vodafone. What do you see the future of telecom companies, not the sector
yes, sir.
As a whole?
Yes, sir. So, sir, right now, because of the intense competition seen in last 3 to 5 years, because of the new entrants such as Reliance Jio, the prices dropped drastically, which had helped consumers. But at the same time, for the companies, it was very difficult because of ARPU, basically average revenue per user, dropped very rapidly. So because of that, a number of companies merged and most of them went out of the sector. For example, from initially 14 companies, it has now come down to 3 major players and one BSNL, which is government sponsored. Right now, because of this recent AGR decision by Supreme Court, where companies will have to pay about 1.45 lakh crores, the situation has become even more difficult for some companies, mostly for Vodafone Idea, which has been into losses for last 6 quarters. So therefore, situation for particularly for Vodafone India is currently very bleak. So now if the promoters do not do equity infusion into the company, it is looking very difficult if Supreme Court is adamant on its judgment. So therefore, it might turn into a situation where Vodafone Idea will also exit from the market, and it will become basically 2-company market plus BSNL if it survives in long run. However, I think for consumer, it in next 5 years, it will not, for consumers, it will not be very bad, because right now the data explosion that has happened, the 4G prices have come down drastically and it is not going to increase very much. And plus coming, the incoming 5G technology that is going to, that has a very bright future for digital economy and for the internet penetration, the services will improve more and companies will definitely work hard to gain more consumers. Therefore, they will not drastically increase the prices.
Tell me, you have been on job or you're in training in Income Tax?
Sir, I have joined it, but I took extraordinary leave.
Have you been exposed?
No, sir. No, sir.
Tell me, this there's a controversy which has been going on and on with every election about the electronic voting machine, about its reliability, about its veracity, about its temperability. So what is the issue which keeps coming in every election and then it dies down? You think these EVMs are temperable, or what is the perception that you have, or the people have?
Sir, in my opinion, EVMs are not basically they cannot be hacked, as various political parties have been saying. And I think people have also confidence in the system, because this kind of allegations have not come from people that much as it has come from political parties. So the question of that whether it can be hacked, there is one side which is basically of the political tussles which keeps happening between the parties. However, recent elections have shown that the results are in the favor of the party which is supported by people. It is not that ruling party has been winning everywhere. So these allegations are clearly false. And apart from that, from technical point of view, if we see that EVMs are standalone machines and they are manufactured by companies which are very reliable, and Election Commission of India also trusts them, and it's a very reputed institution of our democracy. So we also have to trust that they have taken the decision to introduce EVM after verifying all the situation.
And you did BTech in
engineering physics background.
Engineering physics.
Yes, sir.
So it was engineering as well as physics. So
yes, sir.
Physics,
yes, sir. Very close to that.
Which development in the history of physics was responsible for industrialization of the society?
So it was industrialization of the society happened because of the steam engine. So thermodynamics was responsible for the introduction of steam engines, and after that, yes, sir.
Within thermodynamics, what was the idea and area that led to this?
Basically that energy can produce work is the basic principle behind this.
Who was responsible for constructing such a machine?
Sir, I'm not able to recall the name of that person. I have read about him, but I'm not able to recall the name.
Did it have anything to do with the conversion of work into heat or heat into work?
Yes, sir. Basically, the basic driving principle behind a machine is that heat can, conversion of heat will turn into work. Just a second, sir. Yes, sir. It was a basic idea that work can be derived from energy.
Uh-huh.
So it is a first principle of thermodynamics itself.
Can you now recall who was the person? No.
No, sir. I'm not able to recall.
Fine. Which law of thermodynamics gives you an idea about entropy?
So it is third law of thermodynamics which basically is responsible for. No, sir, it's the second law of thermodynamics. Second law of thermodynamics, yes, sir.
Now, what is entropy?
So, entropy is basically the measure of disorder in a system.
So, and we say that the disorder in the for every reaction that takes place, the disorder increases.
Yes,
the
sir.
Entropy increases.
Yes, sir.
So, the entropy of the world is increasing continuously.
Yes, sir.
What would happen ultimately? How long would it continue to increase?
So the second law basically says that entropy cannot decrease. So it will continue. It will continue to increase.
How long? And what would happen at the end?
So the theory is that so various thermodynamic theories say that ultimately that after, for example, universe is expanding, which is saying that entropy is increasing in the universe. But the theories say that ultimately the universe will collapse into a singular state. And
yes, sir. Right nowadays, the Prime Minister is saying that Lok Sabha and this state assembly should be held simultaneously.
Yes.
So what do you think? Is it feasible or what are the limitations?
Sir, under current constitutional provisions, holding simultaneous election will not be feasible because of the various provisions. For example, collapse of various assembly could take place at middle of 5 year period, which will make it difficult to hold simultaneous election. So in order to do that, a number of constitutional amendments will be required. Apart from that, in my opinion, I do not think simultaneous elections will be a good idea, because definitely there is a cost component there which is in favor of holding simultaneous election, which would decrease the cost. But ultimately, the idea that multiple elections hold the government at both national and state level accountable to the people, and it keeps reminding them that what issues matter to people is ultimately holds greater importance in a democracy. Therefore, I think that the current system is working fine. However, we should synchronize elections in some phases. It should not be happening every year. We could synchronize nearby elections to hold simultaneously so that the repetitive cycle will be reduced.
So recently we had general elections in
Yes sir, in 2019 itself.
2019.
Yes sir.
And the JNK assembly was in suspended animation or dissolved.
Yes sir.
They could have held at least that election with the central government.
So election for JNK assembly.
What may be the limitations? The government could not have the elections. This is
so for the yes sir, I got the point. So one reason was that in JNK situation was security situation was difficult at that time. Only a number of attacks such as Pulwama attack had happened, which has complicated the security situation. Secondly, the abrogation of Article 370 and converting the state into union territories was in process.
Article 370 happened in August.
So it happened in August, but the process should have been started.
May
2019, yes. So the process had been must be in the place, and I think the most important reason was that security situation was not good at that time.
Recently, have you heard in the paper that the USA has dropped India from the list of developing countries?
Sir. Yes, sir. The not developing country status. So yeah, because in their opinion, India has developed, its per capita income has crossed $2,000 per $2,000, and under WTO rules as well, the number of exemptions that have been allowed to developing countries was based on the per capita income, which was about $1,000.
What will be the impact on Indian trade?
After dropping from developing country status. So, sir, they have scrapped a generalized system of preferences, which gave preferable access to Indian goods to their market. So, because of that, there will be some impact on manufacturing sector. However, it will not be more than, as per some data from Ministry of Commerce, that the impact will not be more than some $200 million as such. Apart from that, currently India is running trade surplus from with respect to USA. So there will be some impact on that, but not a lot, because India is in trade surplus because of services export, which is not going to be hampered in near future.
But they have stopped the discounts they are giving on certain Iran. Will affect India?
Yes, sir, it will impact India, because India has strategic interest with Iran. Firstly, the oil and gas import from Iran had to be reduced because of the pressure from the USA. Secondly, it had to be reduced, and a number of companies brought down the import from Iran because of the pressure and the threat of sanctions, which was USA was saying that it will impose on India.
What is the stand of India?
Sir, India had said that India does not believe in unilateral sanctions from such country. It only believes if the sanctions will come from UNSC. So it did not completely eliminate the trade, but it had brought down the trade, oil trade, up to some extent. And secondly, the Chabahar port that India is developing in Iran will be impacted, and the access to Afghanistan currently is via Iran only for India. So that could also come under a threat because of this US-Iran tension.
US has decided to withdraw its forces from Afghanistan.
Yes, sir.
The impact of
So currently Afghanistan Afghanistan is not in a very good place when seen from the standpoint of how strong Taliban there is. So Taliban still is attacking in a number of places in Afghanistan, and the government there is very weak. If USA withdraws its forces from there, then definitely Taliban will come back to the position where it had once occupied almost whole of Afghanistan. Also the Pakistan has a very influential relationship with Taliban. So Pakistan will definitely get greater say in the matters of Afghanistan, which will certainly worsen the situation. And if USA withdraws from there, then other regional players such as China could basically pursue their interest in the region, which could in long run not be good for India because of the Pakistan's support to terrorism.
Recently government has merged BSNL and MTNL.
Yes, sir.
What is your opinion regarding merger?
Sir, I think merger is a good idea because BSNL and MTNL, both companies were running into losses. Now after the merger, the resultant company could better monetize its asset, could better rationalize the workforce that was basically in excess earlier. Now the bullet
earlier experience of merger of Air India and Indian Airlines.
I'm sorry, sir, which companies?
Earlier merger of Air India and Indian Airlines, that was not good.
Yes, sir.
So do you think this merged companies will survive?
Sir, particularly from the telecom point of view, if I see, then the survival of the resultant company will very much depend on whether it acquires new technology. For example, BSNL is still not performing very good in 4G technologies, which is going to be the future in India. And now with upcoming 5G, if it does not builds up its equipment and infrastructure, it will be very difficult for it to survive. And it could in long term become a loss making company for government. However, in short term, sorry sir,
what is the role of TRAI?
So TRAI is Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. It looks into it looks into the regulation of the sector, that the sector is no, companies are not getting involved into anti-competitive practices, and predatory pricing is not happening. Apart from that, it suggests to digital communication commissions about the spectrum prices and various measures needed for the sector to flourish.
In the next coming 5 years,
yes, sir,
only money will remain and everybody will be out of the market.
No, sir, I don't think so. It will happen. In the market, two to three players would be. So TRAI is not intervening because till now the as per their definition of in the definition of predatory pricing, they had said that only those companies would be penalized for predatory pricing which have significant market presence, and then they pursue reduced prices. And for significant market presence, they had set the idea of 30%.
India is, yes, sir, cheapest data rate.
Yes, sir.
So 30 paisa or so.
Yes, sir.
And the European countries and all, they are having some more than 6 rupees.
Yes, sir. Region. Yes, sir.
Don't you think the TRAI should restrict this?
Sir, TRAI should not be fixing the prices. That would be an interventionist measure. The prices should be based upon what the suppliers, what is the demand-supply balance, basically what the user is willing to pay and at what price the company can supply. And Jio came up with a system where they started with 4G services only, and they rationalized their prices in a manner that they could provide services at cheaper rate, and in five to 6 years they could become profitable, and they are on their way to do it.
Tell me, I see that you take an interest in women's issues and gender sensitization, right?
Yes, sir.
So tell me, regarding women's safety, what measures can be taken?
Sir, for any social issue, the changes should be at three levels: attitude change, infrastructure, and institutional level change. So first of all, for women's safety, attitudinal change should be pursued in a very focused manner. For example, currently what happens is whenever crime against women happens, the victim shaming happens at all levels, at the family levels, at the society level, and sometimes even politicians and the iconic figure in the society come forward and say that it was the fault of the women. It should be at least at the level of these icons and politicians, it should be banned that they cannot do this. This kind of attitudinal change is required at all level, which can only come from education, which is gender sensitized, and the content is not it is not colored against women. That kind of content we have to prepare. Teachers should be sensitized that they promote the education that men will be men. Attitude is wrong. They don't have the right to commit violence against women. Secondly, at infrastructure level, women's safety has to be promoted by deploying more CCTV cameras, providing last mile connectivity for women to safely travel when they are going for their work. And at the level of schools, for example, there needs to be toilets for both female and male students. These kind of infrastructural changes are required, which keep the gender sensitivity part in their focus. Thirdly, change at the institutional level, which is change at the policing system, change at healthcare system, where the women who have gone through violence, these are the first line of defense, these are the first line of contact for women. Often it is seen that even police and healthcare professionals are not aware how they have to behave with women. They discourage them from reporting the cases. In case of rape cases, even healthcare professionals are very insensitive about this. These kind of things have to be changed at institutional levels.
Now tell me, what is your view on this, what we started recently, capital punishment for rape of minor?
Yes, sir.
Is it a progressive
law? Sir, capital punishment has been only prescribed for one, heinous crimes against women, and secondly, when the girl child is below 12 years of age. So that is the maximum punishment that will be given. So in a way, it is a progressive move that it may create deterrence, but there are certain apprehensions, because mostly rape cases against women or girl child are committed by the family members. So it may discourage the family from reporting the case itself. So both the things have to be taken into account, and ultimately what should happen, that the implementation of the law should become should be prioritized, because currently the conviction rate itself is very low. So deterrence will not just come from the maximum amount of punishment, but the certainty of punishment, that the person will be punished if they do this thing.
Lastly, tell me, how do you see the Me Too movement in India? What has been
it? Sir, Me Too movement in India certainly gave a voice to a number of women who in number of industries, for example media, Bollywood, where women came forward and kept this well kept a secret in the open that yes, sexual harassment happens in workplaces, and the people responsible for it should be punished. They should not go free. However, at the same time, we see that this issue has only remained limited to upper middle class women, women who are working in domestic areas, women who are working in other professions such as maybe teaching, healthcare. They have not come forward. So this movement has had been limited to social media itself. Because of that, sexual harassment happening in other areas have not come into focus.
So you think like those alleged to have committed sexual harassment, they should be named and shamed publicly without a proper trial?
No, sir. Without proper trial, no punishment should be given to anyone. And this shaming of people in certain cases have destroyed their career. So without proper proof, evidence and the proper trial, this the identity of both victim and the alleged culprit should be kept secret as far as possible.
But wasn't that what the Me Too movement was all about?
Yes, sir. It was. Sir, it was about saying that this has happened, but it was not about that the industry should boycott him. For example, a number of writers and actors were boycotted from the Netflix itself, who were working there. So without proper trial, how can a company take decision that this person is a culprit and they should be removed from this? That has definitely in a way impacted their career.
Thank you, Pratibha.
Thank you, sir.
Step out for a minute now.
Okay.
Call you back.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.